selfie drone review. This drone is also sold as a Hosi brand 007 Pro pocket selfie drone. You can also find it with different brands, but it's all the same aircraft. The SM2 Moment 2 version with the GPS and the optical flow sensor. The box is quite simple. Let's go see what's inside. Inside the box, we'll find a case, the user manual, power supply brick. It's 110 240 volt 1.3 amps with an output of 12 volts 3 amps power cable. And inside this pretty nice, I must say, bag, it's a drone, the battery, and the charger base for the battery. The Moment 2 quadcopter is a brushless quadcopter, size of 200 millimeters from motor to motor. It's a pretty well-built drone. It has a very nice feeling, like a bit of rubbery, but not so rubber. It's plastic. The drone itself with the battery weighs about 405 grams, quite bulky in my opinion, for a pocket, as it's a drone. On the front we have an operation LED that blinks when the camera is recording, and a 4K camera that can record up to 4K video at 25 frames per second and 1080p video at 60 frames per second. The camera moves with a servo mechanism. Do not try to move it with your hand. There is also a warning label here saying do not move the camera with the hand. Underneath we see a small optical flow camera and ultra sensor here. Both these are parts of the optical flow system this quad has to hover, especially inside. On the top we see here the main body of the quadcopter. Here is the SD card slot. One thing that you should know is that this drone records video up to 60 megabits per second. Thus it needs a pretty fast card regarding write speed. Initially I used a Class 10 U1 card and a Class 10 card, and noticed that I had a lot of jello and in some cases dropped frames. I had to change the card to a much faster one, a U3 type card. Let me show it. I'm using this card. It's a Kingston 32GB U3 card. In any case, you need a card that has over 20 megabytes per second write rate, otherwise you'll get into trouble with a video recording. The battery, it's a 2900 milliamps battery. It's a LiHV lipo high voltage one. It's a smart type battery. Fully charge it and do not use it, after 2 days it will discharge to 50%. To install the battery, it needs to hook up with these two grips here, which is a bit problematic because you have to really press it down in order to click and stuck in place. Otherwise, you risk the battery to come loose when it's flying. I'm trying to install it. You have to make sure you hear a click. I do not hear a click from this side. You need to hear the click, because right now the battery, it's easy to get off, as you see. That's the only negative regarding the build quality I found on this drone. The battery installation is a bit problematic. There, now it's secure. Take some effort, unfortunately. You press and hold the power switch to turn it on. Search on the Wi-Fi network list of your device for an XT2200 access point. The password is 12345678890. Searching. Okay, it's connected. Let's see it now. Yes. Enter the Moment drone app, which can be found on both the Apple Store and the Google Play Store. I think the Apple version is a bit more refined than the Android one, because some options on the Android, especially the visual follow option, do not seem to work. This is the main interface of the application. On the top right, we find the settings menu. The rotator settings allows you to adjust how the virtual joysticks will work. It switches between mode 1 and mode 2. I'm using mode 2. The sensitive setting changes the way the quadcopter responds to the controls on the screen. I chose intermediate. I do feel, however, that while using the screen recorder, although this is a pretty fast smartphone, there is some kind of lag. Some cases there is some kind of slow response between clicking an icon and actually performing the operation. On the calibration menu, we have the compass calibration, which should be done outside after the GPS has acquired some satellites. You simply press start calibration, twist the aircraft normally clockwise, then vertically counterclockwise, and that's it. The accelerometer calibration can be done inside. We'll do it here. You place the aircraft on a pretty level surface, click start calibration, and it's calibrated. That's it. It's pretty simple. And finally, we have the camera setting menu, which allows us to change settings for the camera. We have single shot, continuous shooting, and timer shooting options for photographs. The photo pixel resolution, 16 megapixel, 12, 8, and 5 megapixel. White balance, which can be switched between various options. And distortion correction that will apply a fisheye removal algorithm to the final image, but not on the FPV display. The camera has a field of view, if I remember correctly, over 140 degrees, quite big. The video option allows you to switch between 1080p 60 frames per second, 1080p 30 frames per second, 720p 120 frames per second, 60 frames per second, 50 frames per second, and 4K 25 frames per second. Lots of options, and the white balance is automatic, sunshine, cloudy, etc. The other options this application has, starting from bottom left, it's this hand icon, which denotes that we're using the tap fly method to fly. This also does not work on the Android, I must say. I don't know if it's working on iOS. I do feel it works on iOS, but not on Android. Press again to switch to the traditional sticks mode. The the icon above allows you to take 10 seconds videos, segments, who knows. This is a timed capture. Above is the optical mode and the return to main screen option for the application. Next to the optical mode, to the flight mode specifically, is the GPS lock. We have zero satellites here, of course, with 99.99 HDOP value, which is pretty bad. To be able to fly securely in GPS mode, the HDOP value should be below 1. Next to it, there is the battery indicator mode. Next is the flight height indicator and the distance indicator from the app, from the smartphone. The next icon is the signal indicator. On the right, we have this icon that allows you to switch the angle. Let me put it here so that I can see the angle of the camera. Can go up to 70 degrees below. You can take the ground if you wish. One drawback I've noticed on the Android version, at least, is that when you enter some menus like this one, which allows you to adjust the camera angle, the other controls do not work, especially the joysticks. So you need you should have a very good GPS signal in order to fly reliably and do not lose the aircraft. Under the camera angle button, there is a button that switches between taking photographs and recording video. And below it is an icon that allows you to enter the camera gallery. That's some photos I took up earlier, where you can delete and download the camera, the video and the photographs stored on the device. The visual follow, although it says begin to enter and present some simple instructions, does not work on the Android. I couldn't manage to make it work, no matter what I did. But it might work on iOS, I don't know. And finally, on the bottom part of the screen, we have the auto takeoff button. Here, the one with the aircraft pointing upwards, and next to it is the camera shutter button, and to the right is the return to home button. This quadcopter has a geofence limit which cannot be removed of 20 meters altitude and 100 meters distance. It's not an issue at all, because you cannot really fly this aircraft. This is supposed to be a selfie aircraft. You take it off, point it at yourself, take some pictures or video, and that's it. You do not have expected to fly it like a normal quadcopter. Overall, the build quality is very nice for this price. However, both the firmware and the app, at least on Android, are underdeveloped. That's a pretty mild statement, because there are some occasions that the aircraft was totally, I couldn't control it, only landed. I don't know if it's the app or the firmware, or the fact that I was using a screen recorder, but it was not a pleasant experience. In any case, I cannot totally advise you to buy it at this state, unless you do not mind having these quirks in hand, because I do not think that there will be any firmware updates for this drone. Application updates, yes, there were three at least in the last year, but not an even single one firmware update for this, which is unfortunate to say, at least, because it has a very good hardware base. It has a Snapdragon platform, the same as Dobby and, if I remember correctly, the Mark II drone. For sure it could perform a lot better if the firmware was optimized. However, if you manage to find it cheaply, it's not a bad option to have just in case. This is an alarm operation that the motor center, if the aircraft is powered on and not flown within 5 minutes. Many racers have it, so that you can easily detect it and find it, which is a good thing for this one. That was the presentation of the SIM2 Moment 2 GPS quadcopter. Thanks for watching. Please like and subscribe, and I'll see you soon. Bye bye.